You're listening to episode 46 of Lifestyle Locker Radio, part two with Peter Riggio.
Some of the very same people that would say, oh, I have nothing to do with that that CBD stuff. Well, then I guess you're going to have to stop. First of all, don't drink anything that has hops in it. Don't have common tea anymore. Okay. Don't take flax, and you can't use echinacea.
Hi, I'm Dr. Josh Hand, and welcome to the Lifestyle Locker Radio, where we dive into what makes an awesome lifestyle. From relationships to money mindset, nutrition to fitness, emotional health to peak performance, we bring you on an amazing journey to unleashing your human potential. In the studio today, we've got Peter Riggio, the CBD guy. To learn more about him, you can check the show notes. His introduction was full in the last one, but now we're going to dive into the legality of hemp, of cannabis, of marijuana, patents that you may want to know about. We're also going to talk about not all hemp or not all cannabis is created equal. So without further ado, here's Peter Riggio. All right, Locker Nation, we got Peter Riggio here again to talk about this amazing CBD. Last time we left off on the last call, we left off talking about male and female plants. What's the difference? Marijuana, hemp, cannabis, what do they actually mean? So, Peter, I want you to actually dive in and kind of dissect the words for us. Well, not really, but dissect, you know, what each one means, because, you know, they're used a lot of times interchangeably by lots of people.
Sure. Sure. So marijuana is the female plant. And so, of course, we know that it's very high in THC. It's very low in CBD. If you didn't know that, that's what's going on there. That's a small, stout, bushy plant, and people obviously grow it to enjoy recreational marijuana, you know, and that's, if that's their gig, it's all good. I'm not knocking it. You know, people could do worse things, I suppose. But what we're talking about on the other side of this is hemp. And hemp is a plant that's high, very high in CBD, and very low in THC. In fact, when both plants are grown together, the production of THC in the female plant reduces to nothing. And the reason why is because the plant doesn't produce the resin to try to pollinate itself. And so they actually grow very well together in what's called cross-pollinating. All of this being so low on the THC scale that it doesn't, it barely registers. And it, since it's organic, a lot of the viewers may not know, but THC has to be superheated in order to become psychoactive. And so organic THC, I mean, you could take any plant material from the male or female plant, put it right into a blender. Doesn't matter if somebody told you it was the greatest marijuana in the world. If you blended it in a shake, it still wouldn't have a psychoactive effect because it has to be superheated to have that effect. That's why people either cook with it or they'll smoke it as an example. And so on the hemp side, of course, that's not the case. But again, when they're grown together and cross-pollinated, they produce a 0.3 or less, which is so low it barely registers.
Okay. And cannabis is kind of the overall
that's term the category
for the actual variety of plant.
Yeah. And it's really a shame too, because the word cannabis is almost almost always related to people getting high. So they go, this isn't cannabis, right? And it's like, well, it's in the cannabis family. It's just, you know, it's like there's two cars, and there's a truck is in the car or in the vehicle family along with a Porsche, but obviously they're not the same vehicles, you know? And so these are very different. That's one of the things that people really get caught up on.
Yeah, and I agree.
I think it's really important to mention the cross-pollinating, because if you understand that the marijuana plant's production of THC is based on being starved from being pollinated by the male plant, this is why it produces so much and has that effect when people smoke it, is because it's been starved of this pollination. So when it's grown next to the male plant, it doesn't have that demand on the plant, and it just is just high in CBD, you know, and all the other plant materials that are there that are beneficial.
Yeah, that's what we want.
Yeah.
That's stuff we really want, right?
Yeah.
So now that we kind of have that overview, let's, you know, I'm sure everybody listening, maybe not everybody, but a large group of people that are listening are going to be like, well, is it legal? Is this, you know, like what does the government have to say about all of this stuff?
Yeah.
About hemp, right? That's what we're going to talk about.
this is truly one of the most asked questions around, you know, and I happen to live in a legal state. Yet I've been a coach and worked with kids all my life, and I'm really anti-marijuana from the standpoint. I don't want to see kids getting high, you know, adults, you know, they're over 21 and, you know, it's probably better than, you know, drinking alcohol all the time. It probably is, but that's not the point. The point is that, you know, I'm not for it when it comes to, like youth, but when we look at the legality, it doesn't even matter if you're in a legal state. There's some rules and regulations, according to the federal government from 2002, and that's the standing law that's been in place. There's been nothing after the fact from the federal government. So these are things that quote unquote classify marijuana as a Schedule I listing. And so in the area of hemp, it still got put into that same group. The difference was what parts of the plant are being used for the extraction. So this is a key factor. So we go to great lengths to extract from the stalk and the seed of the plant, which, by the way, happens to be very high in omega-3 oils. It's a perfect ratio, very, very high in that, lots of protein and other great stuff there. So it's a very useful portion of the plant. But you got to use a lot more material to get that oil. But we go to great lengths to do that. And also the oil is imported from Europe. So let me give you the three conditions to be outside the Schedule I listing. Number one is what parts of the plants are used. So it needs to be the stalk and the seed, can't be the flower or the leaf of the plant. The second thing is it needs to be below 0.3 or below on the THC level, which we already described that as being organic, so it's non-psychoactive anyway. It's remarkably low, and we qualify there. The third thing is if something is grown inside of the U.S., and then it crosses a state line. Doesn't matter if it's grown in Washington, a legal state, and sold to Oregon, a legal state. That matters to the federal government. The moment it crosses the state line from even a legal state because it's grown, the federal government still refers to it as Schedule I in terms of its growth, cultivation across all 50 states. So it could only be cultivated within a state that is legal to sell. Okay, however, when it's imported from Europe, it's legal in all 50 states and, in fact, delivered to 38 countries. We'll talk about what's going on in other countries later with respect to that. But know that we've qualified under all the regulations to make this available so everyone could get the benefit of cannabidiol without having to cross that line with the DEA and the Schedule I listing.
Oh, that's great. I mean, that's good. So just so I'm clear on this, but you know, there's a lot of, you know, a lot of stuff that's spoken about, you know, can't do this, can't get that, can't sell it here. I have patients asking me questions about it now, being that is it legal. So even if it's the hemp plant that's produced in California, it can't be that product couldn't be sold. If it's CBD, low THC, it couldn't even be sold out of state.
Correct.
Wow.
Okay. And that's why companies there's a company, I think it's called Charlotte's Web or something.
Yes.
Something like that. Now, they had their products taken in Alaska because it had crossed the line from Colorado. I believe Alaska is a legal state too. And so they came in and took it. Okay. And they'll continue to do this because the moment they cross out of Colorado, which is now if they had a facility in Alaska, then they could sell in Alaska. But the moment they cross that line, and it's just really hard for them to police this up. You got the mail system and stuff going out. And but these companies are walking a very, very dangerous line there with the federal government. They have lawyers that tell differently. But the reality is those are the laws. That's where they stand. So that's what creates that difficulty. Yeah.
All right. Well, that's good to know. I mean, you know, I'm buying it from from Innate Hemp. You know, I'm getting it here in New York State, so I've been using it for I don't even know 3-4 months, 5 months already.
Yeah.
I've been using the green labels. What I've been using now for a while. I love it, and the X of my dog.
I want to tell you something really powerful right here. It's 775 farmers in the collective that met the requirements of what we needed for our cultivars, right, to produce the highest quality CBD available, okay? 775 in this collective. In Austria and other countries throughout Europe, this is happening. But what's really neat we've also set up the first triple lab testing. And by the way, if anybody wants to know, no GMOs, no pesticides, no herbicides, no molds, no heavy metals, triple lab tested. Who created the triple lab testing for the industry? We did. It's awesome. We say we want to bring that quality, that sort of medical grade sort of quality to this industry. It was a very convoluted space, people all over telling you things. And it's like, let's hone this in on what's really happening. Let's follow the research, follow the studies, and follow the correct procedures. And so, yeah, that triple lab testing was put together best. Tested when it comes, when it's first harvested, tested again after extraction, and tested again for percentage of CBD before it goes out to the customer. Pretty awesome stuff.
Yeah, that is great, actually. So you're actually getting what you say you're getting.
Yeah.
Which I'm sure is not true everywhere else.
Every single batch. No, no. In fact, the DEA did a run through, or the FDA did a run through on this. This is back about 7-8 months ago, or maybe a little more. I lose track of time sometimes. I'm having so much fun. But I got to tell you that when they did this, they picked 100 companies. And out of those 100 companies, there was two companies that were true to the label. Some of them didn't even have CBD in it. Other ones had a much lower percentage. Okay. But only two companies were that. And one of them was us. I won't mention the other company. It's not necessary.
Exactly. Exactly.
I mean, it's amazing that there's that much, I don't know if you want to call it fraud, but in mislabeling, just basically lying to the consumer. Sad.
It is sad. It is sad. So now that we kind of hit the legal portion, let's talk about some of the patents that are actually out there for CBD, for hemp, what we're working with.
Yeah. Yeah. That's good stuff. So the U.S. government has a patent, I believe it's 2004. Sometimes I get my dates turned around just a touch there. But 2004, let's go with that. I believe that's the correct date. With an award or Nobel Prize winning doctor named Dr. Julian Axelrod. You can look this person up. It's quite a remarkable story behind this person. But he was part of the team that came in and showed cannabidiol as neuroprotectants, anti-inflammatory, anti-Parkinson's, anti-Alzheimer's, and they did this, they got their patent. I think they filed in 98, and they got it it was either 2002 or 2004. I think it was 2004. And then it just sat around. Josh, the thing sat around. Nobody did anything with it. So a company called Canna Life Sciences was issued, and by the way, that's associated with our manufacturer, and again, right back to our company, the first license from the National Health Institute to pursue the work that started there. So we've been working on that since 2009, I want to say, is when we started and got that license, that first license to do that, and continue the work. So they're constantly developing and looking into how different, there's over 80 to 100 different cannabidiol in the plant. So they're looking into how different ones react differently with the body and how some of them are accumulating in these receptors and those receptors. Science deeper than you and I could ever dig into. But the bottom line is it's cutting edge. And there's over 1,200 medical journals out there published that show double blind studies and all kinds of things that are the benefits of cannabidiol. So it's actually the most talked about medical subject on the planet, they say, right now.
Wow. And you mentioned something. This is a big word. You said neural protectants. We kind of flew right by it. But what people don't realize, and I think this is an important take home right here, is when we say neural, we mean central nervous system or nervous system to the whole body. And you've heard this on the podcast before, but your central nervous system controls every single function in the human body. So if we're doing something that helps that system, what else can get helped? You got to answer that yourself, right? The entire body. So,
yes.
I mean, we don't need to dive into the medical or the health terminology, but if it's a neuroprotectant and we know that scientifically, it's been proven, and you said 1,200 journals on this stuff, that's amazing. The central nervous system gets help, the whole nervous system, really, not only the central nervous system gets help, that means from the brain down.
Yeah.
That's huge.
It really is. And as you heard from the last one that we did on this, there's more receptors to receive cannabidiol in the body than all of the receptors combined. I mean, that is such a huge statement to think, why would we have all these if it wasn't meant to receive it? And then, of course, that's what led the science behind it to discover that there was an endogenous version of that CBD, right?
Yeah.
But there's all these receptors. And in today's, you know, the way it is out there today, I mean, in terms of our smog and our radio waves and our GMOs and the depletion, I mean, I don't want to gloom and doom, but it's pretty bleak. It doesn't take a lot to get behind in your body. And so feeding this system is just, it's just like giving it the best of, you know, like in chiropractic, when you align the body, it does what it's supposed to do. Same thing. You give it enough fuel, the ECS will just knock it out of the park.
Yeah. The proper nutrients. This is a supplement, really. We're talking about supplementing your diet or supplementing your health, really, with something that's actually made from the planet that's putting right back into you. It's a really cool thing. And I'm really stoked that I don't want to say stumbled upon this. Granted, uh-huh. I've been in college before, you know, I mean, for the other side, but yeah. You know, hearing more and more about this, it became like such a big curiosity just less than a year ago. And I'm like kind of going all in on it. And I absolutely love it. Uh-huh. So besides the patents here that you're mentioning, you know, around the world, there's a lot of stuff going on in the CBD world, if you will. You want to touch on like globally, like what's going on?
Absolutely. I do want to add one more comment in regarding additional credits that doctors can now get to learn about the ECS. And there's a term called the endocannabinoid deficiency disorder, which if you have that, your entire system is shutting down. You can look up the guy that put that in. I see you writing there. That's awesome.
Yeah,
look that up. That's amazing. And so doctors that are, you know, have already graduated and they're out in their practice, they don't know a lot about the ECS if you ask them. But now they can go back and get credits for learning it because they're teaching it in schools now. They're teaching about the ECS. They're saying, hey, this is the largest regulatory system. This is what it controls and handles in terms of function. So this knowledge is becoming very common to people, and we're just on the cutting edge of it. You know, it's just amazing. So on that cutting edge is in terms of our manufacturer and who they're working with, 38 countries right now. And I kind of highlight a few of those. One in particular is Brazil. Brazil, over one child that was dealing with seizures, the parents, when they had the cannabidiol seized by the Brazilian government, they said, look, to keep this from our child's life depends upon it. You know, this is totally cut the seizures back from, you know, it's like 60 seizures a day to like zero, right? And so the Brazilian government immediately put together, you know, there's a court case, and they came in and they showed the documentation and some very key people as far as PhD doctors and people came down there and said, hey, look, here's what's happening. And can you believe within 30 days, the Brazilian government not only authorized it, but they subsidized for 1,000 kids, paid for 1,000 kids that had seizures. And now doctors are prescribing in that country, our products in particular, being prescribed by doctors down there from everything from Alzheimer's all the way through to, you know, things like lupus and fibromyalgia and Crohn's. I mean, you name it. They're all in there. It's being prescribed for that right from a doctor's office in Brazil. And so that's the kind of things that are happening. You know, in the U.S., things move a little slower. I don't want to beat on the FDA too much, but I think they've long since been paid off. And pretty much if you hand them enough money, they'll go ahead and give you an authorization on anything. So you throw a couple billion at them, you can get this pharmaceutical drug approved that has, you know, what, 97 potential side effects or something, you know. And you're scared. You know, they, more than half the commercials describing the potential side effects. You know?
Yeah. I mean, if you can't watch TV, open a magazine, turn on your phone, a computer without seeing, you know, a dozen ads in the first hour.
Yeah. You try to add this stuff up and you've got no side effects coming there and no narcotic. There's no drug effect here. And, but nothing but reported benefits. I mean, it's like a giant wave going out around the world of people saying, I've watched videos, people, you know, telling stories and in England just all over the world, people talking about what's happening, and they can talk much more freely in other countries. So it's like always exciting for me to talk about other countries because they're doing things that are, you know, they've got the same research It's just our ability to catch up with it and take action, right?
We got to take action. That's what we got to do as a country with this type of stuff. And like, there's a big stigma around all of this, right? I mean, we look at the past, and like we mentioned before, you know, marijuana. You know, it's like everybody assumes that when you say the word cannabis, it's the marijuana plant versus the hemp plant. So like, the stigma, where does that really come from? Like where in history do we start to see this?
Yeah, well, considering it was part of our economy here in the U.S., I mean, people have said this, I'm sure you've heard this before, you know, our constitution's printed on it, you know, as part of a regular crop, you know, you had to use a percentage of your crop. But more importantly, when people walk into a store, they'd actually, back in the day, they'd get tinctures of it, and they reported incredible results in terms of the health. And then we saw this drop off in 37, in 1937, because of a guy that owned all these big tree farms and was in the paper business and didn't want to compete against hemp. So he created propaganda behind marijuana. That's not to say marijuana doesn't get you high, but let's look at the facts. Okay. We've got echinacea. How many people use echinacea?
Yeah. Right.
Okay. Some of the very same people that would say, oh, I have nothing to do with that, that CBD stuff. Well, then I guess you're going to have to stop. First of all, don't drink anything that has hops in it. Don't have common tea anymore. Okay. Don't take flax, and you can't use echinacea. Okay. And there's a few others, but I'm just naming a few. So let me get it straight. Right?
Yeah.
Don't want CBD, but I love echinacea. And, you know, or I use flax in my shakes or what have you. The point being is that hemp's just abundant in that CBD. So it's amazing, though, to me, when someone gets something in their mind, especially generationally, you know, it's like generations of saying, oh, it's those outsiders. Like, remember the movie The Outsiders, the hippie guys are the outcast, right? But that was centered around people getting high. But it creates this stigma in the brain. It's almost like a conflict that people have trouble, you know, getting over. But all they really need to do is go to their internet, choose the search engine of their choice, and start researching published medical documents on CBD. Start looking at the endogenous, the amazing ECS system, and how it's got its own functioning mechanism to feed itself with CBD and the essentials of that. And I don't think it'll take any person very long to conclude that they were very wrong about this and they needed to reconsider it and engage. Because this is one of the greatest things that's happened in my life. I don't want to go on and on too much about it, but when you're sitting in my seat and you're dealing with the text messages and the emails and the people thanking me, the tears of the joy that people are saying to me, saying, I can't believe, you know, this has happened, or I'm trusting you on this. It's not going to get me high, right, Peter? I promise it's not going to get you high. You know, just take this much and increase the serving size until you can get to that desired, you know, result that you're looking for. And I get these text messages. I have a retired chiropractor, 74 years old. His name's Gary. I won't mention his last name because I didn't ask permission. But Gary called me up saying, oh my gosh, my wrist, you know, that was bothering me, you know, from all that chiropractic. You guys put it out. I mean, you're doing work there.
Yeah.
You're making these adjustments, you know, and you know, it's like the pain in my wrist, it's completely, you know, like gone for him. You know, he's got problems with his knees and he's had two knee surgeries and a hip surgery. And he just keeps ordering and wanting it and just praising me. In fact, he offered Josh to be available if I wanted to bring him on any podcast or anything to talk about his own personal experience. So if we ever want to do that, we can. He's that excited. He's in retirement. Maybe he's got a lot of time on his hands.
Yeah, but, no kidding.
But his daughter took over his practice, and she's excited about it too. And it's just, this is what my day is filled with. So you can't tell me otherwise when you're hearing, you know, just real people telling their real results and how it's changed their life, and also what they've been through on the level of being given narcotics. You know, various different narcotics to manage all these different types of pain. And, you know, everything here that was necessary was right here on this planet. You know, it was given to us right at the beginning. And here we are. We're searching out over there, the folks in the white cloaks, right?
Yeah.
Here, I'll prescribe this, for it, but they're all things that kind of cover it up. You know, I do understand you got to manage pain to get some healing going on. But boy, you know, we've seen some pretty terrible stuff out there with people getting hooked on things. My sister being one of them. She had to come off of five different prescriptions she was on, and she'd been on a variety of prescriptions for 22 years.
Yeah, and that's unfortunately very, very common.
It caused a seizure in her. She had a seizure from the medications. She fell and hit her head, and then she had chronic headaches. It was just one thing after another. And we're not dealing with it no more, and it's exciting stuff.
Yeah.
So
I mean, going back to the stigma, I mean, I'll raise my hand and say, you know, I was that person when I first started hearing this. It was never on my radar, but when I first started hearing about CBD, I'm like, oh, why the hell would anybody want to use this stuff? I'm like, everybody's going to be stoned all the time. They're, you know, they're going to, you know.
Yeah.
And, you know, I've obviously come full circle and realizing like, wow, no, you're not getting a buzz. You're not getting any of this stuff. And you're just getting health benefit. And it's like, I take fish oil. Oh, my God. You know, like, it must be a terrible thing to take, right? You know?
Right, right.
You know, I kind of keep in that same type of, if you will, category of a nutritional supplement. It's just part of my daily regimen. So
it's working.
Yeah. I absolutely love it. Yeah.
The body, right? Listening to our own body.
Yeah.
Famous quote. I say famous. I don't know that the guy's famous, but I've been using it for years. And it says, all the conversation in the world won't change a thing. Yet it's your own experience. You cannot deny it. You know, and so when we have an experience, for us, it's everything, right? But when you tell it to someone else, they may not pick up on all the power behind that because they haven't had that experience. So I would say people just have the experience of it. It's not going to get you high, and listen to your body. See what it says. You know, when my kids would, I'd tell them they had to try every food, you know, they had at least try it once. Well, I'd say if they had a look on their face before they tried it, like they already had that look, like, I ain't going to like this. I said, that doesn't count. That doesn't count. You have to have an open mind to be an open book. So if we can open ourselves up, we can go ahead and try something that maybe we haven't tried before. And just trust me when I tell you it won't get you high, because if it did, I wouldn't be using it. And let that experience guide you. Then what you'll be able to do is maybe touch some other people's lives and people you care about around you. And we all know a few. We all do. Yeah.
Yeah. So that's really cool. So I didn't want to end it on this high note because this was a pretty solid. I mean, we got a lot of content in here in this short, like 25 minutes of time. And I don't want to ramble on more because I know people are going to want more content and actually want to start getting this stuff. So I want to thank you. The Lifestyle Locker crew, you know, listening in is going to thank you too. So Peter, thank you so much. And we'll be talking again.
Okay. Have a wonderful day.
Thank you. Okay, Locker Nation. I know all of you want to find out more about where to get this high quality CBD that's sold in, what do you say, over 38 countries, the highest quality, triple lab tested, clean, and legal, more importantly. So we can get them all over the U.S. here. So we will have at lifestylelocker.com, we will be selling all of the Innate brand of hemp oil. You can get them directly through us. That website will be up very shortly, or actually the store and the website will be up shortly. So you can get all your hemp needs and you'll find out more. There's different kinds like we were speaking about. Like I said, I take the green. I think I'm actually transitioning over to the blue so I can have all of the great benefits of both different types of CBD. And that's about it, Locker Nation. So check out lifestylelocker.com. Make sure to give us a 5-star review if you're enjoying these on iTunes. It would make me really happy. And you know what? If you do that, screenshot it, send it to me. I'll actually mail you a sticker while I have them, while they last. They're starting to go out on people's computers, on their cars, on a locker maybe. So talk to you soon, Locker Nation. Bye-bye.